Need a sandbox or are they unmuted? Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath.
We're so glad to see you all here on this brisk and beautiful winter Sabbath day. We are nagayon for bringing us all here safely, and we praise the Lord. We're here to sing praises and lift him up in glory. What a delightful Sabbath that we will have as we sing songs. Let's say a quick prayer before we start. Thank you, Heavenly Father, Lord. You are so good to us. You are so good to us, Lord. Thank you for bringing us all here safely, and thank you for the presence of the Holy Spirit and the holy angels as we lift our voices in praise to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And our first song will be page 152. Tell me the story of Jesus. Faithful.
Mm-hmm.
There's no page number on it. There's no other name like Jesus. Does anybody have a number for it? Okay.
Choose a different numbers. What's up? Choose a different song.
Can we choose something? The words are on the screen.
See how to play. Okay. Choose a different numbers.
Give it a different number.
We can sing 267, please, Miss Lawrence. Thank you, Miss Laura.
Oh, the joy of food.
Good morning. This morning there's a second reading for Ginny Lonzer to be one of the teachers in the beginner Sabbath school class, and then also for Dwayne McFadden to be an assistant teacher in the early teen classroom. Is there a motion? A second? All those approved say amen. And there's also a first reading in the back of your bulletin for a manual that is wanting to transfer down from Florida up to Northside, and we'll have a second reading on that next week. As you might have read on the screen before, there's been an offer from a donor for matching funds up to $10,000. That is for money that's raised before December 23rd to help send the Pathfinders that have already committed to go to the Camp Ray and Gillette next year. So I ask that you keep that in mind as the Lord allows. It's not cheap getting all the way down to Gillette, but they have a lot of good things, and it's a good experience for our kids to be able to get down there. I believe that there's a women's ministry announcement here shortly. Also, there's a Arctic Mission Adventure. There's also a matching opportunity there for up to $25,000 for offerings made for Arctic Mission Adventure by December 30th.
Happy Sabbath. Okay, ladies. Thursday, December 14th, we are going to Mexico. That's right, Mexico and Alaska. It's a restaurant. We're going to have lunch at 12:30. I know a lot of you are working, can't go to lunch, but then a lot of you aren't, and you can go to lunch. So if you can join us for lunch, it'll be fun. Invite a friend. It is order off the menu, self-pay. We're not providing lunch, but we are going to get together and socialize and buy your own lunch, and it'll be fun. So I hope to see you there.
Today's a special day because it is the Sabbath, but it's also a special day because someone turns 8 years old today. They're trying to catch up to you, only 92 more years. Is there anyone in here that's turning 8 today? Could they please stand up? Or sit down in the back over there. Let's sing happy birthday. What? Oh, to Anna. It's Anna's birthday today. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, I bless you. Happy birthday. Let's open today's service with a word of prayer. Bow your heads with me, please. Lord, thank you for the privilege of gathering together with other believers. We ask that you lift all of us up to you today and tomorrow and the next day when people listen to this and watch and reflect upon the message today. We ask that you prepare us to receive the message that you have planned for us today, and that you guide us in implementing a path closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Page 142, praise and song.
Yeah. To come in our altar for our prayers. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we praise your name. We thank you, Lord, for your love, your mercy, and for this day that we can have the freedom to come and worship your name. We thank you, Lord, for everything, for giving us good health, for your blessing. And also, we ask that your Holy Spirit be upon us. Help us to open our hearts and that you may dwell in our hearts. Thank you, Lord, for our trials, that we can glorify your name. And also, I lift up for those that are sick, that you may touch and heal our the sickness, and for those that have challenges, that you may guide us. We pray, dear Lord, for those that are not here with us. You know our needs before we even ask. But you also are true that if we ask, we will receive it. So please, Lord, we ask your presence to be among us, and also for today, that you will bless our meetings, our service, and may you anoint our pastor as he preaches the sermon today. Thank you, Lord, for all the promises that you have given us. We claim them, and In faith, we ask all these things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
I invite the children to go back and pick up a basket to collect the children's offering on their way up for the story. The children's offering goes to support youth ministries here at Northside. Who has ever been out in nature and seen a pretty wildflower? Have you ever seen a bee or an insect on a flower walking around? In Australia, they have a flower called the sundew, and it has a small, delicate stem with round petals. And it can be white or red or pink, and it's a pretty flower out there in the field. And it has these little, like, hairs that come up out of it with this dew that looks like water. And the insects like to fly around, and they see those pretty flowers, and they land on them to check out those flowers. But what they don't realize is the dew at the end of those little hairs in the flower is sticky. And first they get 1 foot stuck, and then another foot stuck, and as they try to get their feet unstuck, they get more stuck, and as they try to get unstuck, they keep moving around, and the flower feels the vibrations of that bug trying to escape, and the leaves slowly wrap around that bug, and the flower has something to eat. When we go through life, sometimes we'll see things that are pretty that are good, and sometimes we'll see things that are pretty that are bad, but it's having that relationship with Jesus to help guide us through our steps that'll help us make the good decisions when we have a choice between good and evil, no matter how tempting it seems. Would someone like to say the prayer? Let's bow our heads. Lord, thank you for guiding and protecting us in our life. We ask that you give us a constant reminder of your love and your guidance,
And that when we're in situations where we feel alone, that we have to make a decision for right, that you remind us that you're there and you are strength, and that you'll protect us in making the right decision. In Jesus' name, amen.
Happy Sabbath. Now is the time for praise and giving. And today our praise and giving is going to our local church budget. And I will read this story. Accessory to a miracle. On December 22nd, Lauren heard that her father needed emergency open heart surgery. He lived in Europe, but Lauren was in the States. To fly to Europe on short notice was prohibitively expensive. An expired passport was also a concern. Her desire was to take her young daughter, Sabine, on this trip. The least expensive tickets were $1,200. She needed two, and Lauren prayed. On Sabbath, Lauren and her family continued to pray. Church members formed a circle of prayer, and the miracles came. First, the passport was renewed in just a few days. Second, a sister in the local church felt impressed to send a check for $1,000 to Lauren. It was mailed before the Sabbath on which the family prayed for a miracle. Third, Lauren discovered that she had enough reward points to purchase a ticket. Fourth, Delta was informed of the story behind the short notice trip and discounted the second ticket to $731. Lauren broke down with tears in her eyes and related the story of these miracles to her father. He also was touched by God's kindness. The following Sabbath, he made amends with God and took part in communion. This miracle was possible because ordinary people decided to serve others. When we give to the local church budget, we too become accessories to miracles. Deacons, please rise. Please bow your head with me for a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity for us to praise you and giving back to our tithes and offerings. I ask that you please bless this offering and let it be used in mission to outreach and minister, bringing others closer to Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Revelation chapter 12, verses 10 through 12. Revelation chapter 12, verses 10 through 12. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, "Now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time." May the Lord add a rich reading to the reading of his holy word.
Two zero seven is our next song. Please join us as we sing It May Be at Morn.
Yeah. Happy Sabbath, everyone. It's good to be here today. Thank you all for who participated here. We're glad that we can worship together on this Sabbath day. Can you believe it? We're in December. Man, we're going to hit 2024. Oh, boy. You know, I remember one time I used to believe that the world was going to end in 2000. I don't know if you guys remember the Y2K stuff, but this is when I was caught up in conspiracy theories. But, you know, hey, that failed. And so, but the thing is, we know that even though we are still tarrying here, the Lord is coming. This is why we had that special music here. He is coming soon. Amen. Before we begin, I'd like to have a word of prayer, and then we'll go right into our message this morning. So please bow your heads with me at this time. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you once again that we can be here today. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to hear from you. And so, Lord, I pray that as we read your word and that we try to understand that you fill us with the Holy Spirit, that we may understand these truths and guide us into all truth. So, Father, I pray that you will bless us now. We ask in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Usually during the time of this season, we get into the sermons that deals with the birth of Christ. But I'm going to deal with that in a couple of weeks. By God's grace, we're going to have a message dealing with the birth of Christ. But I'm going to share this sermon and the next sermon, what led for Jesus to be born. Does that make sense? Right? Because we often talk about the birth of Christ, but why did he have to come? What happened? Something happened for him to come here. And so we're going to basically pull back the curtain to see what went on behind the scenes. Does that make sense? And I want you to follow with me along to see why Jesus had to come. And so we know that as we've been going through the themes in Scripture and going through Genesis, and we're going to hone in by next week, Genesis chapter 3, on the fall of Adam and Eve, but there was another party that was there, and it was the serpent. And here we always wonder, how did Adam and Eve fall? Like, how did you fall for it? Right? And oftentimes we don't realize we do the same thing. And so this is some of the things that we are going to cover today. And here we have to understand how Adam and Eve fell and why we are in this predicament. We must understand what happened in heaven. How is there a perfect God, a perfect relationship with his creation, a perfect atmosphere was disrupted? Could you imagine there was a time where there was no issues? Don't you wish you have that here? Where we just are in total unity and harmony. There's no drama, but there was drama in heaven. You know, as a kid, I always used to ask my parents all the time, well, how did we get here? What, this doesn't make any type of sense. Because God is all powerful. He can just end it just like that. Isn't that true? I don't know about you. I've asked that question. So here we're going to just unpack a little bit here. And as we've been talking about creation and how creation was the act of love. God desired to share his love with his creatures who were freely receive and freely give. Turn me to the book of Psalms here, Psalm 89. If you turn me to Psalm 89, I want you to notice something here that what the psalmist says about creation. Psalm 89, starting from verse 13. Because we're talking about God being all-powerful. And notice it here in verse 13. It says, you have a mighty arm, strong is your hand, and high is your right hand. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Mercy and truth go before your face. Blessed are the people who know this joyful sound. They walk, O Lord, in the light of your countenance. Here we're talking about a powerful God. And it says here that your hands are strong. Strong is your hand. And then in the when we're talking about his throne, it says righteousness and justice, or judgment is the foundation of your government, of the universe, an all-powerful God. And he is powerful. Here you can see who God is. It's interesting in the Patriarchs and Prophets, she says that the sovereign of the universe was not alone in his work of beneficence. He had an associate, a co-worker, who could appreciate his purposes and could share his joy in giving happiness to created beings. See, the Father was not alone in this. He had a son, and not had a son. They were equal together. They were one in purpose and in nature. And he created all things, the Son of God. Matter of fact, notice in John chapter 1, turn me there, John chapter 1. And many of us know this verse in John chapter 1. John chapter 1, starting from verse 1, it says, in the beginning was the what? Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through who? Through him. And without him, nothing was made that was made. And you skip down to verse 14, it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That Word is Jesus Christ. So as we were been going through Genesis, and Genesis chapter 1 and 2, we know that it was Jesus. He was the Son of God who created all things. Remember, the Godhead, they have different attributes. And here, this reveals his attribute. It says, in the beginning was the Word. What is the purpose of words? To communicate. And here, this is why you know, especially in the Old Testament, when it says God would come to the patriarchs and communicate, it was the Son of God. He's the Word. And what's the purpose of communication? It's to have a relationship. Also notice in the Bible here in the book of Colossians, turn me there, Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, and some of us are definitely familiar with this one as well. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 16. It says, for by him, talking about the Son of God and Jesus Christ, by him all things were what? Created that are in heaven, that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions and principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him. This is a powerful God. So here we see that Christ was one with the Father in nature, in character, and in purpose. And here she even alludes in Patriarchs and Prophets that the only being that could enter into counsel and purpose of a God. So that means when the Father wanted to have a meeting, only the Son of God was allowed in this meeting. And the Holy Spirit, of course, but in there, they would have counsel together. Again, we realize that the government of God, the foundation of his government is righteousness, judges, justice. The law of love is the foundation of the government of God. The created beings were in perfect accord with principles of righteousness. God desires that all the creatures have a service of love. That's what was going on in heaven. The love of God was supreme. Love for one another was revealed in an unselfish way. That's how it was in heaven. There was no strife and no conflict. Could you imagine that? A time, there was a period in time where there was no strife and conflict. But there was one person who perverted the freedom of God. And we called him Satan. Matter of fact, prior to that, and we're going to deal with this, he was called Lucifer, but his name changed to Satan, and Satan means adversary or accuser. Now, there are several chapters in the Bible that deals and expounds on this accuser. And if you notice here in Genesis chapter 3, you will see there's the accusation initiated. In Job chapter 1, there's also accusation. Isaiah 14, Ezekiel 28, Zechariah 3, Matthew 4, and Revelation chapter 12. We see here the it expounds on Satan being accusing God of something. But we're only going to deal with two of these chapters in the Bible. We're going to deal with Ezekiel chapter 28 and Isaiah chapter 14. We're not going to go cover everything, but this is something that you can do today or wherever this week and just search. Notice in Ezekiel chapter 28, turn me there. And here, this is very interesting. In Ezekiel chapter 28, this is going to be interesting here. We're going to start from verse 1. And here, this is talking about the prince of Tyre. Tyre was a wealthy city, and there was a prince who thought high of himself. And notice in Ezekiel chapter 28, starting from verse 1, turn me there, it says here, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, say to the prince of Tyre, thus says the Lord God, because your heart is lifted up, and you say, I am God. I sit in the seat of gods, in the midst of the seas, yet you are a man and not a God. Though you set your heart as a heart of God, behold, you are wiser than Daniel. And here it says, there is no secret that can be hidden from you. With your wisdom and your understanding, you have gained riches for yourselves and gathered gold and silver into your treasures. By your great wisdom in trade, you have increased your riches, and your heart is lifted up because of your riches. So this is what the prince, as a matter of fact, Josephus, some tried to find out who this prince was, and Josephus, a historian, a Jewish historian, said that this prince was during the time of King Nebuchadnezzar, and this prince was named Ethbal. And here, this king, this prince, he thought high of himself because he had all the wealth, and here he claimed to be God, right? And here, and we still have people who claim that today. And here, God is telling Ezekiel, he says, look, I'm going to let you know what is going to happen and how this individual is going to fall. And actually, who's working behind that individual. It's interesting, the fall of the prince of Tyre can be summarized with the fall of Adam and Eve in the garden. The main issue of Adam and Eve's sin was their attempt to claim divinity and independence from God. Because you remember, what did the serpent say to Adam and Eve? To Eve especially, he said, look, if you eat of this fruit, you shall have the knowledge of good and evil. Well, you can be like God. And here, that's the temptation. Oh, yeah, I want to be that. And here, this is what was happening with the prince of Tyre. Eve took upon herself the prerogatives of God's sovereignty. Here, the prince of Tyre took upon the same quest and met the same reminder of human limits. Instead of seeking to reflect the image of God in obedience, mercy, and love and justice, when he would accumulate wealth, he became proud, prideful. Then Ezekiel goes into who is behind the scenes with the prince of Tyre. And notice here in verse 11, Ezekiel chapter 28, it says, "Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, take up the lamentation for the king of Tyre." Now there's a difference. This is not talking about the prince here, but who's working behind this prince? "And say to him, thus says the Lord, you are sealed of perfection, full of wisdom, perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God." Now, was the prince of Tyre there? Was he at the garden of God? No. So here, he's now speaking, God is speaking to Lucifer himself. You were there. And it says in verse 13, "Every precious stone was your covering, the sardis, topaz, and diamond, beryl, onyx, jasper, sapphire, turquoise, and emerald with gold. The workmanship of your timbrels and pipes was prepared for you on the day you were created. You were the anointed cherub that covers." Now, what's a cherub? An angel. And here it says he was the anointed cherub that covers the glory of God. Now, many of you know the sanctuary. I know there was a Messiah's mansion that came here a few years ago, right? And remember the Ark of the Covenant? You had the two cherubims on each side of the Ark of the Covenant, and they had the wings that covers the Shekinah glory. That means Lucifer was right next to God. And here we can see that there is, even in heaven, there was this hierarchy that took place. There were different positions for angels. See, folks, there's nothing wrong with that. It's when you abuse your power. And here, this is where he was the anointed cherub in verse 14. "I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God." Remember, the mountain of God correlates with the throne of God. You were right there. "You walked back and forth in the midst of the fiery stones. You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created till iniquity was found in you. And by the abundance of your trading, you became filled with violence within. And you sinned, therefore I cast you as a profane thing out of the mountain of God, and I destroyed you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the fiery stones. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom, and for the sake of the splendor, I cast you to the ground. I laid you before the kings." So here we can see that this is a character profile of Lucifer. You see him in a pre-fall character where we can see that he was perfect. That's what the Bible says. He was created perfect. God did not create Satan. We should say amen to that. Because there are people that have many questions. Why would he do this? Why would God create Satan or the devil? Here we can see, even when you read patriarchs and prophets, that he was holy and undefiled. He reflected the glory of God. He had the highest power and the glory amongst the other angels. He was wise and beautiful. He was perfect. He was created perfect. But then something changed. It says his heart was lifted up. What's a word for that? Pride. So he was prideful. He was self-centered. He wanted to serve himself. He was jealous. Well, jealous of who? He was jealous of the Son of God. Now, the question is, why is that? It doesn't make any sense. See, the thing is, and I was sharing this with my wife last night, that you're only jealous of someone when you feel like you are equal with that individual. So like her brother, my brother-in-law, he's a provost for a university in Michigan, Western Michigan University. I'm not jealous of that brother. He's on a different level. I don't want that. I don't want to be a provost. But if he was as equal to me, there's a temptation to be like, Well, I want that job. I think I can do better. So that means he felt that there was this equal idea of who the Son of God was. Probably they may look alike. So like, for instance, we were talking last night. There's a habit of my previous former colleague of mine. His name is Steve Conway. Usually in camp meeting, because we look similar, according to people. Not really. But we both have the same color skin, so people always call me his name. They say, oh, hey, Steve, how's your kids? Wrong person. Right? And because they see that we have similarities, right? And here, often, that's what we do, right? But here, this is what Lucifer is thinking. He said, wait a minute, there's similarities with the Son of God and me. And how come he gets to go to have council meeting with you, Father? And I'm not in the meeting. And here, this is the drama that took place. Now, do we see that today? Oh, it happens in church. Oh, we're going to get there. We're going to come. We're going to come there. So the thing is, this is what he does. And here, this is what was happening in heaven. He's like, wait a minute, I should be up there with the Son of God, but yet I'm outside. Look at me. I look good. Don't you see me? Here we can see that he was cunning. He was not content with his position. And oftentimes that's how we react. When we're not content about something, we respond in a certain way. Notice again in verse 16 of Ezekiel 28, it says, by the abundance of your trading, you became filled with violence. What does that mean? Here we see that the work of disseminating rebellion in heaven is compared to this, his discontent. So what he was trading is he was sharing with them and giving them false views about God. Gossip. So he started to chatter. That was the trading. He was selling that amongst the other angels. Remember, perfect God, perfect relationship, perfect atmosphere. That was remember, they had no idea. They were like, wait, excuse me, what? Remember, what's another name for Lucifer? He has Satan, and then what else? The devil. Now, notice the definition of the devil is the Greek word diabolos, which is slanderous, accused falsely, malicious, gossips. Oh. Because you always went, wow, how could this be? How could this happen in heaven? You see, all this drama, the reason why we celebrate Christmas and Jesus was born is because of gossip. That's why Jesus came. All that started with gossip. See, we often think of the extreme, like violence. We think of like murder. Folks, that's not what was happening in heaven. When the Bible said, we'll talk about this, when it says there was war in heaven, that word war is the Greek word polemos, which is politics. It was an argument. It was a physical violence. Here, see, the war of words. And oftentimes we don't realize how words can damage. And this is why we're in the predicament that we're in. Satan started it from the beginning. Because he wanted to be in the council. He wanted to be in the meeting. He's like, I deserve to be in that meeting. So I'm going to start talking bad about him. Here we can see that there's a sense of insecurity. And what happens when you are insecure? You're ready to tear others down. That's what we do. Right? We want to tear people up. And we don't realize that our words can damage others. So here, when we think about this, and we think about, you know, well, man, this Satan is crazy. But here we can see that we also do the same things that he did in heaven. We see that in the secular world, and we also see that in the church. Folks, it's dangerous. And here, next thing you know, look, I've heard somebody came to me not too long ago and say, Pastor, I heard that you know, this is a rumor that you doing this, that. I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm like, no, that's not the case. I was like, well, you go to that person, whoever's saying that, tell them that's not the case. Stop the rumor. Folks, I'm telling you, this is what we do. Okay? Here we can fall into the same trap. So here, even as a child, just understanding this, I'm like, well, if God is all powerful, well, how come he couldn't just get rid of him? Right? Isn't that easy? He's all powerful. He could just, boom, done. The thing is, we have to understand, it's not a matter of strength. An idea is harder to kill than a person. You see, you can kill a person with no problem, but how do you kill an idea? See, the thing is, that's, you know, as a child growing up, I used to love comic books. And now we see all this Marvel stuff in movies. And it's the same concept. It's who's stronger than the other. But they never could kill the idea. See, that's why there's always more comics. Because it's always the same issue. But here, God had to sue something to kill the idea. Because even if he would have got rid of Lucifer right then and there, Satan right then and there, that idea would have stayed in heaven. He has to get rid of it. Thing is, I want us to understand something here. And I'm going to read some quotes here that is profound, just so you can see what took place in heaven. Notice this quote. I'm going to read several quotes here. It says, the true position of the Son of God had been the same from the beginning. Many of the angels were, however, blinded by Lucifer's deception. He so artfully instilled into their minds his own distrust and discontent that his agency was not discerned. Lucifer had presented the purposes of God in a false light to excite dissent and dissatisfaction. While claiming for himself perfect loyalty to God, he urged the changes were necessary for the stability of the divine government. While secretly fomenting discord and rebellion, he caused it to appear as his sole purpose to promote loyalty and to preserve harmony and peace. Isn't that something? Discord, discontent, discord, discontent. This is what he wanted. He wants strife. See, that's the thing, folks, we have to understand. We can't get caught up. Even, I dare to say, there's something when you get even a position in church. We get, you know, we want to feel, oh, yeah, I'm important. Or even if you have a key to the church. Oh, I'm in. Folks, we need to be careful. Look. At the end, it's not about us. It's about his work. And we get caught up into, you know, all these little things. Or I'm important. And what happens, it builds pride. And then what happens is that you start chirping, and it causes discord, discontent. Yes, amen. There you go. I get one. Look at it. Notice this. While there was no open outbreak, division of the feeling of imperceptibly grew among the angels. Some looked with favor upon Lucifer's insinuations. They were discontented and unhappy, dissatisfied with God's purpose in exalting Christ. But angels who were loyal maintained the wisdom and justice of the divine decree. Christ was the Son of God, one with him before the angels who called into existence. He had ever stood at the right hand of the Father. Wherefore should there now be discord? So again, you see this constant discord. And here, the devil is a liar. So he started to share lies, and he covered it like it was a religious thing. Notice here, this is a story of redemption. Lucifer refused to listen, and then he turned from the loyal and true angels, denouncing them as slaves. These angels, true to God, stood in amazement as they saw that Lucifer was successful in his efforts to incite rebellion. He promised them a new and better government than they had, in which all would be freedom. Great numbers signified their purpose to accept him as their leader and chief commander. This is why the Bible says in Revelation chapter 12 that he took a third of the angels in heaven. Now, you see what's happening here? Here the devil's like, look, if you follow me, I'll give you more freedom. See, the thing is, he wants to restrain you. God wants to restrain you. You really don't have freedom. If you want to follow me, you'll have liberty. And here, they're like, yeah. You got to remember, they're created beings. They think as well, like we do. Oh. And here, he's trying to sell. And this is what, look, folks, again, polemos, war. Don't we hear that in politics today? They're trying to sell you. And you're like, yeah, yeah. And we believe it, right? They're selling. That's the argument. They're selling. And they say, oh, well, I promise you this. You're being restrained. Here, all this stuff was happening in heaven. Can you imagine that was happening in heaven? That was the drama. Here he promised them liberty. Here he says, look, if you submit to me, you will no longer be restrained. Notice in Isaiah chapter 14 now. Isaiah chapter 14, turn me there. Here this is talking about in Isaiah chapter 14, just the context. Isaiah 14, God is revealing how the king of Babylon is going to fall, and you're going to see the same thing in Ezekiel 28, that who is behind this idea of their mentality. And so here we know that this is talking about the king of Babylon, but I want you to notice who's working behind the scenes. And it says here in verse 12, how are you fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? Isn't that a good question? How did you fall? Notice what he says here. Oh, it says, how are you cut down to the ground who weakened the nations? For you have said in your heart. Now notice what was in the heart of Lucifer. I will ascend into the heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Now, what's the repetition of word that you hear? I. Isn't that what happens when we become prideful? What's the letter in the middle of pride? I. What's the letter in the middle of sin? I. It's an I. He had an I issue. I will. Now, remember I told you about the chiastic structure and how when you have the writers of the Bible, the authors, when they wrote in chiastic form to emphasize a point. And here in verse 13 and 14, there's a chiastic structure. And notice the structure here. As you can see, it says, I will ascend to the heaven, and then it is repeated in the bottom, I will be like the Most High. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. Now, understand, stars in the Bible represents angels. And notice this, I will ascend above the heights of clouds. Clouds is also represented by angel. But notice the emphasis. The emphasis says, I want to sit on the mount of the congregation on the farther side of the north. Now, understand, remember, the context here, he's talking about the king of Babylon. Now, understand the mindset in the Babylonian in their mythology. They believe that their gods held councils on a high mountain where they determined the affairs of the earth. And here, the king wanted to have that place. I want to conduct the affairs of the earth. Well, Isaiah is revealing that this is exactly what Lucifer wanted. He wanted to conduct the affairs of the universe, a created being. He wanted the worship and adoration of angels. Could you imagine? This is what he wanted. He wants the worship. He wants to rule the whole universe. That's what he wanted. All he wants is worship. Notice he wanted it from Christ. Notice again, Matthew chapter 4. Turn me there. Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4. And remember the story of here Jesus is going through his temptation in the wilderness. In Matthew chapter 4. And notice verse 8. Again, the devil took him upon an exceedingly high mountain. Why? What was the mountain all about? Because this is where you conduct the affairs. You're on the top. Remember, it says that Lucifer was there at the mountain of God. He was the throne. He took him there and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you will what? Fall down and worship me. See, it's not even just only worship. He says, I want you to fall down and do it. Which means that I want you to submit to me. He wants worship. And he's the created being. Here they went to the high mountain. And here he's like, look at all this. Fall down and worship me, and you'll have all this. Folks, this is what we're dealing with. Understand, we're in a battle here, and it's over worship. God wants our worship. The devil wants our worship. Notice in Revelation chapter 14. Revelation chapter 14. Revelation chapter 14. And notice verse 6 and 7. It says, I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, kindred, and tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God, give glory to him, for the hour of judgment has come, and do what? Worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea, and the fountains of water. Now, who's that person? That's God himself, the Son of God. But he's worthy of worship. See, it's all about worship, because notice in verse 9. Notice verse 9, it says, if any man worships the beast and his image and receive the mark in his forehead and his hand, the same shall drink of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture. See, there's two battles here. Now, who's working behind the beast's power? Revelation 12, 9 says the dragon is working behind this beast power according to Revelation 12 and verse chapter 13. So here, the devil wants worship, which he's called the dragon, and God wants worship. See, the thing is, God is worthy of worship. The devil is going to force you to worship him. Now, you would say, well, that's not me, Pastor. But you got to remember, what was he doing in heaven? See, when we start doing this, when we're causing discord where we're not thankful and we're not, because you know, we're not content with our position. When we have that in our hearts, folks, I'm telling you right now, we're right there in verse 9. See, we keep looking at everybody else. Oh, well, that's the other people. But this is what you see as happening here in Scripture. The issue is that God wants our loyalty. There's a battle of loyalty. God wants our loyalty. The devil wants our loyalty. Now, you got to remember, we talked about how can God, who's all-powerful, get rid of this idea, to kill the idea. Revelation chapter 12, notice in verse 10. It says, then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come for the accuser. Now, who's the accuser? Satan, who accused them before our God day and night, has been cast down. What does that mean? Well, he was cast to the earth, remember? He was kicked out of heaven. Remember, it says there was war in heaven. He was cast out to the earth. But, you know, there was another casting down. And you can read that in your time in John chapter 10, where Jesus says that when I am lifted up, I will draw all people into myself, and the prince of this world will be cast down. Wait, what? What do you mean? You got to remember, prior to the death of Christ, Satan had access to heaven. He used to go travel to and fro. You see that in Job chapter 1. He was going to and fro. It's because you got to remember that even though Satan was cast out to the earth, there was still doubt in the universe. You got to remember, they still was like, man, you know, he was a good leader at one point before he did all his thing, but they had sympathy for Lucifer. So God had to do something. He had to let sin play out. See, that's the thing. Sin is a mess. Okay? And we see it. So God has to allow. This is why we see suffering. He has to allow it so people can see what sin can cause. Right? And so here he had to let it play out. And it got to a point where they had to see. The universe had to watch and see, how far is Satan going to go? And it went to the point, says, I'm going to take the Son of God and put him on the cross. That right there sealed it for the angels in heaven. They said, no more. That's why it says, when salvation has come. Remember, salvation happened when Jesus died on Calvary. That's the key. That's how he killed the idea. But see, the thing is, what's interesting is that notice what it says in verse 12 of Revelation chapter 12. Notice what it says here in verse 12. It says, therefore rejoice, ye heavens. Why are they rejoicing? Because now that he has no more access. He has no more access to heaven. He's here. He's staying here right on this earth. It says, and you who dwell in them, it says here, but woe, in verse 12, therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and you that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil has come down to you, having great wrath, because he knows he has a short time. So here we see that the devil is like, okay, I have no more access up there. All right, I'm going to get your people. And notice what he does. Notice in verse 13. Now when the dragon saw that he had been cast to the earth, he persecuted the who? What does woman represent in Bible prophecy? The church. He's like, I'm going after them. And folks, he's been attacking us till this day. And we fall for the trap. Folks, we have to understand what's happening here. This is the great controversy. This is the war between good and evil. This is why Jesus came as a babe. To undo, to help us to see the love of the Father, the love of God for us. That we can't fall into the trap. So we have seen through, and look, there's so much in here. We have seen how it all started. We have seen what he wanted. We have seen how he went about doing it. Folks, we need to be careful of not doing the same thing. We cannot fall into the trap. He knows he has a short time, but he's going to make you think that you have plenty of time. So we can remain having issues with one another. We can remain prideful because we have certain positions. We can attack one another and gossip. Folks, it's dangerous. Folks, the thing is, Jesus came and he lived a life so we may follow. That here the devil got to a point and says, I want to get rid of him. The devil had no idea all the plans, because that's why I said sin is messy. You end up doing things and you're like, man, how did I get here? That's what happens with sin. How did I get to this point when I'm doing this with so-and-so, or I'm doing this to this person? How do I get to the point where I'm being physical or verbally abusive? How do I get to this point? And this is what she used this. She used this in the book, Patriarchs and Prophets. Little by little, it steps. See, he didn't have a plan. This is in Lucifer, and he didn't have a plan. Even though he had the jealousy in his heart, he didn't say in his plan, you know what? Years later, we're going to kill him on the cross. That wasn't his plan. It's just that's what happens with sin. You start doing things little by little. All of a sudden, you're like, okay, yeah, let's do this. Or let's do this. To the point, here they put the Creator on the cross. Folks, I don't know about you, but I don't want to fall into the trap. As you have read here in Revelation, that he's doing his thing. He's like, I'm going to attack the church. Let's not fall into that trap. Is that your wish today? That you want to be protected? Here, Jesus sealed it for us today. Folks, this is why heaven rejoiced. Can we rejoice as well? That Jesus came and gave us salvation and gave us hope. Amen. That there is going to be a time where the whole universe is going to be a place where it's a perfect atmosphere with a perfect God and a perfect relationship. He's going to bring it back. Amen. And by God's grace, I want to get there. Is that your wish today? Let's pray together. Father in heaven, Lord, we want to get back to where it was before, where there was a perfect atmosphere and a perfect relationship with you. And Jesus came down, Lord. We know that you sent your Son to live a life that we may follow so we can have that experience. So, Lord, I pray that you would help us. Forgive us, Lord, if we have fallen short. Forgive us if we have said things to hurt others. Because, Father, we need forgiveness, because we know that if we are partakers of these things, we are causing the same issue that took place with Lucifer. And, Lord, I pray that we don't do the same. I pray that we can look and fix our eyes on Jesus Christ and live the way he lived. So, Father, bless us, guide us, we ask in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Show the world the glory of Let's bow our heads together. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.